performance here. They just left the battlefield and come, you know, to Bangor to talk to us about dance. And this project, Explaining Dance, it is a project run by professionals with over 30 years of experience in the field of dance and the performing arts. Gabriela Niel and Tony Jola. The project, it is quite special because it has, throughout the years, has been awarded many prizes, but just in 2018, it was awarded the prize, may not be terrible here, the Critics' Prize to Scenic Arts in Catalonia. Okay, so its main aim is to bring the arts to the public. And maybe that you can explain a little bit more about this.
Thank you for Arkia. I don't speak too much English, Eva translating. But thank you, Ramon Llull, and thank you, Eva.
I forgot to thank Alice, Don Ramon Llull, which has very, very kindly funded.
Explicar dansa, sobretot és un projecte que el que pretén és donar eines al públic per facilitar la lectura de la dansa contemporània.
But the main aim of explaining dance is to give tools to the public to understand, you know, to understand that the contemporary dance in particular, you know, the history of dance as such.
Doni té el rol de ballarí-intèrpret. Jo sóc la que porto tot l'altre per fer-ho possible, o sigui, tota la gestió i la producció.
Tony is the interpreter in terms of dancing and also, you know, explaining the history of dance. And the trio is the person behind, you know, making everything possible in terms of production and all the organization that this requires.
Per mi hi ha un concepte que és molt interessant, que és que hi ha oficis que requereixen de fer una transformació professional. I en aquest cas, el Toni fa la seva transformació de ballarí en un moment que ja no pot mantenir el ritme d'estar a l'escena al 100% a explicador de dansa.
I'm mentioning that there are some professions that we all have that you reach a point in life that you can no longer do that. Because it can be quite a physical and taxing for the body. And what Tony has done in the past few years is done a transition and used all his experience as a dancer, because he's worked in key you know, dance companies, which I want to tell you a little bit more about. And then use all his experience as a didactic tool and to just bring it, you know, more to the public.
Okay, yes.
Right, I'm just going to give you just a brief about all the three people involved here today. You've just met the trio who's been talking here, and she is an arts producer and a cultural manager, and she specializes in dance. She has been a key figure in contemporary Catalan dance for many years. She directed the magazine Dansa 79, for example, and she's worked with renowned figures and dance companies in Catalonia, such as the Gelaret Azopardi Dance Company. She has also undertaken many other projects, including IT Dansa with Catherine Allard, and coordinated the project Don Dansa for the Bureau of Arts Promotion of the Diputació de Barcelona. She has been a director of administration of La Caldera. This is a very, very important, you know, space for Catalan dance, Center for Dance and Stage Art, and a member of the board of the Association of Dance Professionals of Catalonia. As a producer, she has worked on projects by La Fura dels Baus, and she worked also on the Olympic and Paralympic ceremonies of Barcelona 1992. So, I mean, you can see the extent of the wealth of experience of the trio here. Tony Jodel has over 30 years of experience as an artist and a dance teacher as well. He combines physical training of actors with the running of a variety of workshops for students, professionals, and artists. from all spheres. During his artistic career, he has given over 900 performances worldwide. And as a dancer, you must highlight that he has collaborated with Gelabert as a party company as well. He specializes in interventions as a performer in shows directed by Albert Vidal, Carlos Santos, Jeremy Savary, Magda Puyol, Marta Carrasco, Joan Marchas, and Jordi Salatés. He has also collaborated with the Vol de Gom, Comedians, La Fura dels Daus, among many others. And he combines his choreographic work with interventions as a performer. Obviously, in the last few years, he's been very, very much into this project, explaining dance, that it is, you know all about it right now. I'm going to introduce Mireia the Carol, who is not here because she just needed some time to collect herself. And she will come just as soon as Tony finishes his talk as well. And she is a dancer and a choreographer as well. She studied in Amsterdam. And as a dancer, she's worked alongside Albert Quesada. The performance that we will see by her today is choreographed by Albert Quesada. She has also worked with Angels Marguerite. And she is also the founder of the dance collective Big Bouncers. Okay. She is an active choreographer, so she's very much working up there and doing a lot of didactic work as well. Today she will perform Solo on Bach and Glenn, by Albert Quesada, and which is based on the Goldberg variations of Bach and interpreted by the pianist Glenn Hall. So, that's it for me. I'm sure that you've had enough of hearing my voice. We'll leave it to Tony to get started. So thank you.
Thank you, Eva.
Well, the sound works. There are shortcuts to happiness. And dance is one of them. Vicki Baum, American writer. Well, I'd like to introduce you to some details about the history of modern dance. So, modern dance speaks. You've all seen this type of figure, legs crossing, cross legs, knees upwards, legs stretch, legs torso stretch, arms in an arch, rounded. This figure rises, and it takes a few steps. For example, this one, or this one, or this one, or this one, or, and all of a sudden, go up. This up is the typical image of classical dance, to overcome the force of gravity. Ballet, classical dance, aim to dance with lightness, be ethereal, almost fly. Such is the case that an artifact was invented to put on the feet. The point shoes were the only contact with the earth is the very, very tip of the toe. Here, on the earth, where we live, we suffer, we get hungry, but in Bali, there is another universe, a dreamlike place where we project our our desires, our dreams. And in this way, starting with theories, with the spirit of the air, sylphs of the air, giants, spirit of the forest, the willies, women's human. And they dance with in a peculiar skin tight dresses, costumes, the tights, the leotards, the majors, dresses that emphasize an ideal of human beauty, an idealization of human body that we can admire in the Greek classical sculpture, the Apollo, Hermes, Aphrodite, Athena, the scholars of Myron, even the Michelangelo's David. In the midst of these appear a wonderful dancer, Isabella Duncan. The first thing that she did was to get rid of these pointed shoes and began to dance barefoot. But because she wanted to feel the sun, the grass, the water, the breeze. And she put on white clothes too, chiffon tunics, veils. She went even nude, not because she was an exhibitionist, because she wanted to feel the freedom of her body. And to feel that freedom, she went to nourish on nature, and she wanted to dance in the air, there the wind, the horizon, the water, the waves, or more exciting movement, the fire, the flames, these ungraspable shapes, or calmer movement, the rotation of the earth, the movement of the planets, the growing of the earth, the growing of the plants. Growing is movement. A tree, branches, leaves. So, water, air, earth, fire, the four free elements in nature, the four base elements in classical Greek philosophy. Isabella Duncan loved the classical Greek culture. But she didn't develop a method of movement. She didn't create a form, a way of moving, but she she left us a wonderful image, a wonderful idea. Dance is the expression of maximum freedom of the body in movement. So she is considered the pioneer of modern dance. 20 years later, there were another choreographers and dancers that they did create a dance method. They created a school, and a very important one was Martha Graham. And she began with a familiar image, the beating of the heart. Laptop, laptop, laptop. Sistol and diastol, concentration and expansion. Collect the blood and spread it. Contract, release. And she plays that in the torso, like the central point of her movement. Because in ballet, the torso is a mere support for arms and legs. But in ballet, the torso is not used to produce movement. Torso, with Martha Graham, torso, abdomen, thorax, thorax, when we breathe. Inhale, release, regulation, contract, release, two action, two opposite actions, a complementary that constitute the flux of movement, that constitute the fountain creative of life. Contract, release, contract, release, contract, and the body appears in a new situation, more rounded. The legs, not at work, but straight ahead. We say parallel position. Even the contraction is deeper, the legs are deeper than the ground, we say. Even this contraction goes to the foot. This foot reach this epicenter, this imaginary center in the torso. So flex, we have flex, deeper than the ground. Contraction, that's impossible in ballet, but we can use that in more advanced. Contract, parallel, release, yeah, contract, release, contract, release, contract, release, contract, contract, contract. So we expand, we have more position in our body, in our legs. We have the standard classical position and parallel point, flex point, because of the contraction, and they are knees everywhere, but the contraction, lateral contraction, flex, flex, flex. So we have more elements to for expression. So we idea of contraction, Martha Graham said, all contraction has an emotion. All contraction has an emotion. Yeah. If I apply a contraction in one part of my body, for example, the shoulders, contraction, timid, shy, embarrassed, introvert, or in one part, in another part of our body, the face. The face. We can see the face of everybody. The face. There are persons that are contracted all day, from the morning till night. I don't know why. Furious, worried, and what are we contracting? We have contracted the muscle of our face, the forehead, the frowning, the eyes, the eyebrow, the lips, even the jaw. So, Martha Graham translated that into dramatic and movement and dramatic and tragical contents. And it's from here that Martha Graham's choreographies deal with myth, Greek myths and Greek tragedies. Medea, Antigone, the Shakespearean dramas, Oedipus Rex. Wow. 10 years later, alongside with Martha Graham, there was another choreographer that they created to another style of modern dance, but from another image, a very different image. There is Happy José Limón said, okay, this object is in vertical position, so it is stable. It is balanced, but if this object goes out of its axis, what happens? Falls. If I apply this simple example to my body, I am in vertical position, I am in an axis, I am stable, I am in balance. But if I go out of my axis, I could fall. But if before falling, I place the leg so I bounce back to my original position, I can dialogue, I can speak, I can establish a dialogue between axis and out of axis, between balance and imbalance, between stability and instability, weight and counterweight. And if I let my weight goes, adding different parts of my body, the armway, arm head and torso, and leg. I have pendulum, movement, swinging movement, rebounces movement, suspension, falling, recovering, axis, out of axis, out of axis. So I have movement, more dynamic movement, cheerful, playful. So, remember, we have first Isadora Duncan with her free movement that nourishes on nature. Then Martha Graham with her contractile release mechanism and her more dramatic and tragic movement and contents. And Jose Limon with this dialogue between falling and recovering and her more joyful movement and vital feelings. These three great styles are the styles that constitute the modern dance. However, contemporary dance began with another, in my opinion, with another choreographer and dancer called Merce Kanden, who revolutionized the dance world. Merce Kanden was a dancer from Martha Graham's company, so Contraction. And he decided to draw this link between contraction and emotion that I mentioned before, and transform this contracted and grounded movement or shape, in this case, into a decontracted and curved shape, as he would call it, curve, a decontracted, but keeping the round of the torso. So frontal shape, lateral shape, back shape, and collecting all the leg work from the ballet, leg work logically incorporating the new position of the leg, flex, parallel, and combining this with this new torso work, he created a new vocabulary well known as the Merce Kanden technique. But he was not just significant for his technique, he was even more so for his ideas, his thoughts that would change the way of that point there, or this other point here, every point in space, every point in space has the same importance. There are no points in space more important another. This point, for example, could be center of my dance. So, for example, now, in order to focus the attention on me, you have had to turn your head, because I am the attention right now. Sorry. So, that's kind of broke with this frontal relationship, this face-to-face relationship between the audience and the artists. And this dancer will dance in every point in the space, in points that was considered an important till then. The corners. Okay, corners. I dance in the corners. Or the edges. Edges. Oh, we can dance here too. Or the wings of the stage appear, disappear. And he went further, even in non-conventional spaces, like theaters. I mean, in the parks, in the TV stations, museums, waiting areas of the airports. Mads Hannigan decentralized and democratized the idea and the image of the space. The space dances to. Another idea. By disconnecting the contraction from its emotional tie, he broke with the idea that Dan has to tell a story, has to explain something. Dance, movement, body, no longer. Dance movement is not depending on the text, on the literature, on the lighting and stage design, props, even to music. Regarding music, his collaborator and composer John Cage said, let the music be themselves, let the sounds be themselves, rather than vehicles of artificial theories or expression of human sentiments. Mads Hannigan applies that to the movement. Please, let the movement be themselves, and not a medium to tell a story. The movement, the dance, is a sign of its own. It's enough on its own. It has a meaning in its own, has the movement has its own valid values. the dance is valued by its plasticity. It's changing of direction, its contrast of rhythm, its texture. Dance is not emotion, but motion. Mascandan said, dance is not emotion, dance is mobility, locomotion, action, process, travel, movement. Dance is not emotion, but motion. It was so opposed to what I used to dance. I used to lead. You know, I am from Mazarra, I am from the Mediterranean culture. And I was very enthusiastic with the passion of Francisco. No music. So when I finished my career in Barcelona, I decided to ask for a scholarship to know more about this new style. And there I went to New York, to Mascandan Studios, to close to near to Tribeca, to Village, you know, everybody's there, right? So, good morning. Good morning, Tony. Okay, you know, class has two parts. One is in the center when you adapt your body to this new vocabulary. In this case, tendi curve, passe curve, balban curve. And the second part is the diagonals, where you put your this vocabulary into rhythm, into the diagonals. No? For example, in classical dance you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 2, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 2 times 8. 16 counts, or in jazz, 4 times 8. 32 counts. Okay, 32 counts. But with Merce Cunningham was a little bit different. Tony? Yeah. Great, great. Good, Tony. Come on. Okay, good, good. Yeah, yeah. I am ready. Thank you. Oh, great, Tony. Okay, let's start. Yeah. I am prepared. We can start. Okay, thank you. Great, Tony. Great, great, great. Tony. Yeah? What are you waiting for? Oh, I am waiting for the music. No music, Tony! No music! No music? Oh, dance is independent of text, of props, of music. Count, just count, Tony. Okay, we are going to count, but if I count, I am counting till 100. Stop, Tony. Stop shouting. Let's move. Okay, let's move. Okay, okay. Move. So, in Cunningham style. So, one curve, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 20, 21, 22, 23, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 40, 40, 50, 50, 60, 70, 80, 80, 90, 91, 92, 93, 100, 102, 104, 200 counts. 200 counts in my mind. That's not counting. Sorry, that's not dancing. That's counting. I am like a robot. I am like a machine. I feel like a calculator. I'm not prepared for contemporary life. I was astonished. I was in crisis. So I need a break. So I decided to go to the window and to get some fresh air. And when I opened the window, Jesus, crikey, what's that? This amazing and fascinating skyscraper, the moon. In the sky, how many windows, how many floors? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80. And when my eyes reached the streets, people living from these amazing buildings, invading these narrow streets, secretaries, directors, official clerks, bank workers, occupying the bus stop, into the tube, crossing the street, hailing taxis from the sidewalk vendor, the hot dog, the cotton cattle, the aspirin, that from the tube, the cleaning workers, the security guards, the porters, the bounders, sorry, hustle and bustle of people. And when I look at the class again, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 14, 15, 100. Jesus, it's the same. What is going on in the street is going on in the class. Then I understood. Dance is not emotional, but a lot of motion. Thank you, Bernd Schanninger. You see why Bernd Schanninger represents the second revolution in modern dance. So, for me, in my opinion, there is a change of paradigm from modern to contemporary dance. And because Bernd Schanninger introduced the new technology, the video, the screens, multiplying this plurality of focus of attention in the stage and in general, see? So, but the Merce Hannigan disciples said to their master, Merce Hannigan, these ideas about indetermination, about independence, about freedom, these ideas about the plurality of focus of attention and tension in space, this dance is not emotion but motion, these ideas are very interesting. We agree with that, but we disagree with your idea about body training, body technique. And Mascanian said, yeah, because this idea is still too much academic. Academic? Me? My technique is a solid, a valued, a serious technique. What do you mean? Academic? I'm not academic at all. Well, Master, your technique is still too focused on muscular support. Muscular support. We need to be flexible. We to get tone, muscle tone. We need strength. We need to be supple or elastic, but this new generation called postmodern dance, the movers would produce the movement based on three main approaches. The first one is that the movement arises from a physical contact between physical surfaces, sliding, rolling, pushing, giving way and receiving, resting, rolling. Second is about articulating the body, about articulating the body. It's an exploration of the body joints. You know, we have almost 300 joints in our body. Well, there are people that have only two joints. We are dancers, and we can dance with all these joints, and these joints are surrounded by liquid, the synovial liquid, the lymphatic liquid, the blood flow, the spinal fluid, and this allows us to move in a softer, in a liquid way. We are 70% water, after all. And the third approach is a collecting elements and ideas of energy of Eastern physical movement practices like Tai Chi. With energy is so calm that allows us to move in a peaceful way. Or I can use this energy to concentrate and explode it like in martial arts and kilo catch again. Judo. And all these approaches revisit the training of the body. I wake in a new technique. More holistic vision, awakening a new concept, the muscular economy, moving more efficiently, with less this movement can be a minimal movement, minimal dance, where less is more. And this minimal movement also can disappear and be an imprint, an image, invisible. An idea, conceptual dance. So we have a concrete and physical dance like contact improvisation, and between this concrete and physical dance and this aspect and conceptual dance. Today, can creators and choreographers can or has a wide space of expression, incorporating the performance, the happening, the multimedia, the visual arts, the robotics, the online languages, the theater, the puppets, the musicals. Why these new creators, they can put forward these claims, these demands, their reflections, in fact, their challenges, in fact, their new creative needs. And all that happened in America, in the United States. But in Europe, what happened in Europe? Why haven't I mentioned Europe yet? Finally. Because in Europe, dance has been marked by two world wars. And this huge event had an enormous impact on individual and group behavior, on existential and social attitudes shown on unrest and discomfort and uncertainty and suffer pain, physical and psychological injuries, broken bodies, trauma, destruction, misery, horror, and all that is captured. All that is captured by German expressionism. And the artist of the German expressionism would echo all this in their variety of disciplines, in painting, Ludwig Kirchner, Max Ekman, Beckmann, Egon Schiele, Egon Koska, the extraction of Paul Klee, Kandinsky, in literature, Kafka, or Rainer Rilke, in theater, Bertolt Brecht, in cinema, Nosferatu by Murnau, Metropolis by Fritz Lang, in music, opera, Arnold Schoenberg, Anton Webern, Alan Berg. And in this artistic context appear the so-called German expressionist dance, the root of dance theater that was developed in parallel with this American style, with obstacles and interruptions due to the two world war, where Mary Wigman is the main figure along with Rudolf von Lammer, who developed a whole analysis of movement and a method of annotation of dance annotation, well known as Lammer notation. And we come to the father, the spiritual father of dance theater, Kurt Jost, with his masterpiece, the Green Table, a harsh, poignant, satirical critic about the political class and war, a common ingredient in dance theater. And he is the master of the great goddess of dance theater, of dance theater, Lina Bausch. His role and he is not a mere executor of steps, seasons, pirouettes. The dancer is also capable of speaking, of singing, or acting. Playing music. Dancing, of course. Be a clown. So, in dance theater, we have dance and expression. Expression and creators and dancers and dancers travel all these paths. The first dance theater, the multicultural dance in the language Cali. The Belgian and French so-called no dance, get a bell. But that's a history for another day. And don't forget too that in Catalonia we have an enormous legacy about contemporary, in this case, contemporary dance with like Gerard Pardi, one of the pioneers of modern contemporary dance in Catalonia and in Spain. Belmonte is the master choreography. Dancers, Angel Margarit, she is now the director of Mercato de Flores, one important house of dance in Barcelona, in Barcelona, in Catalonia. Malpelo, Maria Munoz, Parvanis, a historical company, like the others, as the others, and Sol Picot, of course, here in the museum, with this impact with the cactus, Sonia Gomez, mixing performing arts and dance. This is the new generation that Valverde now. He's the director. Just now is composing choreographies in the operas in the world around. And Pere Faure, a young choreographer too, and participating in very, even José Robert López Espinosa. These are very international choreographers right now. Laria Guadet, of course, too. Gina Adler, Maria Campos. They are dancing right now in Europe and in America, too. And Albert Quesada. Albert Quesada, that with Mireia, that now we are going to see, this is Mireia, we are going to see this this piece based on
score movement, but I prefer that Mireia will tell you about this piece. I'm going to call Mireia. Wait a minute, I think it's right here. Mireia! ¿Qué tal? Muy bien. Ok. And don't forget an ancient Japanese proverb. We are full whether we dance or not. So let's dance. We might dance. Thanks.